Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Dear colleagues. So, my lecture is connected with a little bit different subject in comparison with previous one. If graphene is a very hot topic now, and you have seen that number of publications continuously grows, and this growth is approximately exponential still for graphene. For this field, it's already the number of publications is stabilized, but still a lot of work in the direction of optical trapping and manipulation of atoms and nanoparticles. The Nobel Prize in this area was in 19th, so the difference may be 10 or 15 years when graphene will reach this level. So, and my lecture is an overview which I hope will give you some only maybe very initial impression about this very interesting area of physics, of nanophysics. This is the many area of science is included in these optical manipulations by of small particles. So my talk outline is presented here. I will stop on some history, on general description of light forces on small objects, then some part of laser cooling and trapping of atoms. So atoms, it's not nanoparticles, but it's some limiting case of nanoparticles. And then I will briefly speak about optical tweezers, about history of optical trapping, optical tweezers physics, optical tweezers applications, and the last topic will be some optical trapping, peculiarities of optical trapping of metal nanoparticles. So, you know that light and more generally electromagnetic waves carry momentum. Momentum is described, is defined by the by the product of electric displacement field and the magnetic flux density. And we can, so it's classical that any electromagnetic waves have some mechanical momentum. But it's more easy maybe to imagine this on the photon language. You know that light is it's a flux of the photons, we can consider this. And photon, you can consider some particle which carry momentum h bar k. K is wave number, and h bar is Planck constant. And for visible photons, its momentum is very small, 10^-27 kilogram per meter per second. But for example, for atom, for rubidium, if atom has this momentum, then Its velocity will be about 6 millimeter per second. So it's more or less observable, and if you manage that atom scattering some 10,000 photons, then its speed, velocity can be changed on the thermal velocity. So this is really can be observed on the atom scale. Light momentum from atom can be change if atom absorb photons, then photons doesn't exist more, but its momentum obtained atom, and atom now is excited, then this atom can emit photons, spontaneous photons. As a result, atom will obtain recoil, and then again change its velocity. So the this change of momentum of light results in a force. You can because the force is changing of the momentum in time, the rate of this change. And this force for atoms and for is in femto or pico-Newton regime, and thus it's not apparent in everyday life. Nevertheless, you can find some examples in space. For example, comet tails. Kepler said in 1619 that comet tails point away from the sun due to radiation pressure. And physics of this is very simple, that gravitation force which particles of the comet to the nuclei of this comet is proportional to mass, means to of the radius, and light pressure is proportional to the area of the particle, and for very small particle we will have some A which for this particles radiation pressure will be larger than gravitational. So here it's comet Hale-Bopp, which was the most widely observed comet of the 20th century. Okay. On the, if we also can observe light pressure, Maxwell in his treatise on electricity and magnetism in 1891 pointed that if in strong sunlight, the energy of the light which falls on the square foot is 83.4 foot pounds per second, then he calculated that there is some pressure on in now it's we in our units in Newton per meter squared. Some micronewtons, and flat body exposed to sunlight would experience this pressure on its illuminated side only, and would therefore be revealed from the side on which the light falls. So its pressure is very small. Nevertheless, in the end of 18th century, Lebedev, Russian This is just observe this pressure, light pressure. But nevertheless, it's very, very small, and the general opinion was that this is something interesting, kind of interest. So it's maybe interesting, but it's never can be used in real life. But the especially after invention of lasers, this light manipulations by small particle was a real practical tool for many, many interesting applications. So, small particle has a different size. And of course, we have to compare its the size with wavelengths. If the particle is very small, it's atoms, molecules, nanoparticles, which radius characteristic size is much smaller than wavelengths which we use to produce optical force. Usually it's lambda over 20, when we can consider particle as point dipole. It means that on the particle external field doesn't change, and this is so-called relay regime. In the intermediate case, when we have nanoparticles with size which is radius compared with wavelengths, we have to use more precise approach to consider interaction of particle with light, and it's so-called Mi regime. And if we have quite big objects, then we can use some geometrical optics approach, and it's simply some reflection of light, and as a result of this the beam change its direction. It means that its momentum push this particle in this direction. So some general approach to calculation of the force which acts on the small particle, we have to use Maxwell's stress tensor. So it's for arbitrary electromagnetic field, this stress tensor, which is written here in such form, it's describe momentum which carry field in a given point. And then if you integrate on the around the particle this tensor, then you will obtain a force which acts on this particle, because you will to calculate this, we have to solve Maxwell equations and find how this particle scatter field. The form of this tensor is still can be written in different forms. It was some well-known discussion of the Abraham and Minkowski, but this is a problem how you split momentum in momentum of field and momentum of polarization in the medium. Okay, it's not so important, and More interesting is both in Rene regime, when you have a small party, typically, as I said already, smaller than lambda over 20. The field can be considered as constant across the particle, and then this electric field induces microscopic polarization, which is proportional to incident electric field. And here it's alpha, it's polarizability of our nanoparticles. And this induced polarization varies together with incident electric field. So we have oscillating dipole, and with oscillating dipole we can associate some current, which is proportional to the derivative in time of this polarization. And this current you from this field, you will have optical Lorentz force, and which gives a total optical force acting on the nanoparticle. And this force can be split in two parts. This is gradient force, which is proportional to gradient of the intensity, and extinction force. So this force is directed in the field to the area where field is larger. So the electric particle will push to the maximum of the laser beam. And scattering force, it's we can consider this force as particle absorb photon and obtain its momentum, or this particle scatters this photon and obtains the change in, of the momentum, difference of momentum of scattered and incident photons. So we can calculate this force, and finally it's determined by the polarizability of the standard polarizability, and you see this famous denominator, which can which lead to plasmon effects, and so on. Okay, calculation here it shows some example of calculations which were done by Dinerovitz in a very nice review of optical manipulations for different approaches, different presentation of stress tensor. But results, general results, what is important that this is a force which is in transverse direction, here force in longitudinal direction in Gaussian beam, which has focused in 1 micron, and particle is in the focal place shifted to the 300 nanometers from the optical axis of the beam. And it's important that force is decreasing with volume linearly. So for small nanoparticle, it's very quickly go to zero. Here it's the same for metal nanoparticles. There is some difference which is connected with plasma effects. What's on this? So it was some general review of the forces. It's a lot of. I understand that it also was not very interesting, but if you look in these calculations of force which acting on the nanoparticle, it's very boring, and only some mathematics and nothing more. So a little bit much more physics you can find in the interaction of light with atoms. So the difference is that in atom we have different energy states, ground state, atom can be in ground state, and there is some excited state. And the energy difference between these states, we can choose some light, which photon energy coincide with this energy difference. So it's so-called resonance, and atom then interacting with the photon can absorb this photon and can go to this excited states, where the atom can live sometimes, and then on the next slide I will show what happened in the next time, but before we can consider some absorption. So atom absorb photon and obtain momentum of the photon and increase his atom's momentum on this value h bar k. There is some other effect, so-called stimuli emission. This is opposite to absorption. When atom already is excited, in excited state, and which is moving in opposite direction to the laser, will be in resonant and can absorb. So the main result of this is that there is some force in standing wave, in two counter propagating wave, which is force which is damping. So if atom go in one direction, there is force which is stopping this atom. And if atom go in opposite direction, we have also force which stopped this atom. This was so-called optical molasses. And it means that in this medium, atom will be cooled. So this and we can calculate what is the minimum temperature which can be achieved in such molasses. And I will not stop on this derivation. And finally, we can obtain a famous formula, this so-called limit. And I can ask our colleague who is sitting here, Boris, can you explain this limit in detail? Why I asked this guy, he was first who obtained this formula in when? Когда? Борис?
Many years ago.
Когда вы получили эту формулу?
Look, many years ago.
I think 78.
So it was a paper Le Toho Pauli in 1978. And Boris Pauli was one person who was in the on the initial steps of the laser cooling. Maybe it's so trivial, or maybe somebody is already, but for this people obtained Nobel Prize for this laser cooling, what I explained. So it's not so, unfortunately, Nobel Prize is only for three persons, so, and many people and informers of it in Soviet Union, your people who was also could obtain this Nobel Prize, but finally it was not so. Only three persons. So it's Stephen Chu, experimental setup in 1986. And then it was some experiments which shows that here it's this Doppler limit, which I explained. But experiments show that in reality it's much more smaller temperature, and temperature is microkelvins for these atoms. And it was something wrong. And this picture is some from original paper, original reprint, which was done by Hal Metcalf. I will later show you. So it could be explained that in reality atoms are not two-level systems. There is some other level which can lead to the additional more strong cooling. And here you can see how it was change minimum temperature of cloning of atoms, and it was to the minimum 10^-9 if you add to laser evaporative cooling, and finally in 1997 it was Nobel Prize for this laser cooling progress, and this was time which, as I said, now is graphene activity. It's the same activity was in was it 20 years ago in laser cooling area. So here you see this Nobel Prize winners: Stephen Chu, Claude Koech, Cohen-Tanouchi, and William Phillips. William Phillips is from USA. He was working together with Hal Metcalf. It's in Stony Brook. It's me with Hal. I had some collaboration in that time. And I would like to say that all papers which was included in Nobel Prize from Phillips was written in and made in exact with cooperation with Hal Metal, and maybe with some coin it was decided that Williams now is Nobel Prize winner, and Hal Metcalf is first in this line. And this guy is Vladilen Letoho, who is also was the person who should be in this sort in three Nobel Prize winner, but for some reason I don't know why it's here. But nevertheless, this Vladilen Letoho is most cited Russian scientist in 18th and 19th. So, and here it's Vladilen Chebatayev. Who is also very famous guy in the laser physics and laser spectroscopy and so on. Okay, so maybe it's not so interesting. I will skip some. It's a part which describes our contribution in this field. As you as I mentioned, that force which is acting, which we can achieve in the laser field, is limited. There is some limit which is determined by the lifetime of the upper state. And of course, it's always interesting to obtain some result which breaks some physical limits, and you can imagine this how you can do. If you have atom in the ground state, and atom absorbs a photon, atom obtains momentum h bar k, and if we organize that this excited atom absorb, interact with counter-propagating photons, which stimulated, and we obtain stimulated emission in opposite direction. Then finally, after this acts, atom will obtain 2 H bar K, and if we do this very fast, we can increase force in arbitrary value. So it's a general idea, but the problem is that how we can organize this process, because atom can take photon also in this direction and obtain finally zero. So we have to regulate absorption and stimulated emission in some way, and in principle it's possible if you use so-called pi pulses. Pi pulse, it's a short pulse which after interaction with this pulse, atom with 100% probability will be excited. So, and if we organize short pi pulses trains that first acts in one direction, second is in opposite direction, then after these two pulses, we will obtain changing of the pulse momentum to h bar k, and as a result, we will have some force which is not limited by the lifetime of the upper state. Okay, so we can, it's not so easy to organize this, but finally we did this and we obtain force which is much larger than the spontaneous force. We did this experimentally, and now this so-called bichromatic flow, bichromatic loss, is quite popular for stopping and collimation of atomic beams. There is another way to stop and hold atoms. It's so-called magneto-optical trap. This device, we have here three counter-propagating field and magnetic field and atom which is not a two-level system. But the result is that we can trap many atoms in many, in small volumes and do many experiments with this atom. This so-called MOT now is some standard device in many, many laboratories in the world, which are working with some coherent interaction of atoms with light. There is some in this direction was also some Nobel Prize for Bose-Einstein condensation in such magneto-optical trap. And it's still some standard, more or less standard, of course it's quite big equipment, nevertheless it's there is also some possibilities to do physics still in this case, but I will not stop on this. Here it's some